but that he loved us and sent his son as a sacrifice to clear away for our sins and the damage we've done to our relationship with God. You know, man, with it being Father's Day, I've been in prayer about how to address today's message, man, with being in a sermon series indeed called Blood Bought. And we've been talking about the benefit, thank you, Jesus, that we get from the blood that Jesus Christ has shed. So I was wanting to bring the two of them together. Father's Day with also still staying on subject with the blood. And then light bulb, it went off. And praise the Lord for Holy Spirit, man, because Denise, we had Denise prayer for our ministry team Wednesday before our service. And as she was praying, she began to just seek Holy Spirit, and she was praising God for the fathers that were in this circle and the fathers that we had in this church. But then she went further, man, and honestly, it was awesome. She started to begin to pray for people who don't know the love of a father. She said, I pray for those people who are coming in either today or Sunday who honestly don't know the love of a father, but that indeed they would begin to feel the true love of the Father. Amen. And it was absolutely awesome. And the love that we can begin to receive from him. And although they may not have had a good relationship with their earthly daddy, that we can begin to develop an amazing relationship with our Heavenly Father. And that's where the Lord began to lead me in this. And so I'm super excited about this message today before Father's Day, because we are celebrating dads, but most importantly, man, we are celebrating, thank you, Jesus, Abba, our Father, who was absolutely mind-blowing to us no matter what in all of the time. Praise the Lord. So it's so cool that you may have thought throughout your life that you can't celebrate this day or that this is just another day. Well, today, all of that changes. And this is going to be an absolute awesome day for you. Amen. Because now you do know, indeed, that you don't just have a good one, but you have an amazing one who was madly and passionately so in love with you. And it's awesome. And I'm excited that I get to show you through Scripture. See, think about it like this. How do we know that Jesus Christ heals? Well, one, because if you've been here, then you've physically seen Jesus Christ heal. You've physically seen it physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and sexually upon people. You've seen his healing hand. But also, as we begin to dig in, we know, praise the Lord, that he is not a God who can heal. He's not a God who will heal, but indeed that he is a God of healing, right? So praise the Lord, since he is a God of healing, that is indeed what it is that he does. So how can we honestly get up here and say that God is so in love with you? Because not that God can love you, not that God wants to love you, and not even that God will love you, but we see in Scripture that God is love. So he cannot help indeed but to love you. Why? Because that's exactly who he is. Now, some of us have a hard time with that. Some of us go, man, I just don't understand how he could love me. And look, I get it. I understand because I know you. No, I kid. Come on. I just kid. But think about that, man. That's what's so amazing about him is the love that he has for us. None of that matters when it comes to his love. None of that matters, man, when it comes to who he is to us. Now, the things we do matter to us, to who he is to us. Hello. There's a difference. When I didn't want a relationship with my dad was still my dad, and he desired to have a relationship with me. But when I finally desired to have a relationship with my dad, man, it became absolutely amazing. And the benefits that I receive from that are phenomenal. You know what I'm saying? And I love that. And so too is it with Christ. He is always going to love us. God is always going to love us no matter what. But when we actually begin to love him, when we actually begin to live for him, the benefits that we begin to receive from that is absolutely amazing. But no matter what our decision is, I want us to understand he is madly in love with you. And praise God for that. I get it. It's hard to comprehend. It's hard to understand. But I understand a little bit more with having babies. Right? I love my sons in an insane, crazy way. But what's so mind-blowing to me is my love that I have for my boys doesn't even come close to the love that Christ has for me. and or the love that Christ has for my boys. I love my boys enough to die for them. I love my boys enough to indeed take their punishment. But to think that Jesus loved us so much, God loved us so much, that they were so willing to take the punishment of the world. Yeah. Even for those whom he knew would never be his sons and his daughters. See, Romans lets us know that God demonstrated his love for us, that while we were still sinners, while we wanted nothing to do with him, when we were spitting in his face, he sent Jesus Christ down to die for us. John 3:16 lets us know, man, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, so that whoever believes in him, not acknowledges, but believes, meaning to make your heart's treasure, that whoever acknowledges him, praise the Lord, will indeed have everlasting life, right? And that's absolutely amazing. Because of the love, thank you, Jesus, that he had for us. God demonstrated his love. God so loved the world. So we know that because this is exactly who God is. And God cannot, nor will not ever deny himself. It's amazing to begin to wake up each morning realizing that God has no choice, if you would, but to be madly in love with you. And it's not you, it's him. And that's what's phenomenal. That's the great news. Why? Because if it was you, you could mess that up. But since it's him, he can never mess that up. It doesn't matter what you've done, where you're at, where you're doing right now. God is madly in love with you because that's who he is. God so loved the world. Not just a little bit, but that he so loved the world that like he could just stare at us all day long and be completely stoked with that, right? Have you ever just like people watched? I love people watching, man. People watching is absolutely awesome, right? But what I love the most, man, real talk, is to stare at my boys. They'll be eating or just doing something, man, and just to stare at Elias and Grayson, man, I just love it. They look silly at times, and they do stuff they don't even know you're watching them, digging their nose or whatever, and you're just like, man, that's my boy right there. You know what I'm saying? It's just awesome. You know, Elias don't know you're staring at him, and he stiffs arm Grayson. You're like, man, that's my boy. You know what I'm saying? And then Grayson gets up, and he's like, yeah. You're like, man, that's my boy. That's what I'm talking about. But I just love to stare at him, man. You almost become obsessed, right? Now, one thing, man, that I hate is like people drive me crazy when they wanna match. Hey, I'm gonna wear these pants and this shirt, and you should wear these pants and this shirt, and then we could be twinsies. And when you're spouses and you're twinsies, it's horrible. It's horrible. It is absolutely stupid. Right? Praise the Lord. Hashtag, I still love you, but hashtag stupid, right? And so it drives me crazy, man. That's why I don't like twins. No, I kid. Stop it. I just kid. But man, there's been plenty of times when that me and Cindy will come out and we'll be like, you ready to go? Whoa. No, ma'am. You got to go change. You can't wear that shirt. It's too matchy. We both got on holy jeans. Only one of us are walking out of here with holy jeans. And it's me. Yes, ma'am, I'll go change, babe. You know what I'm saying? But, man, I will come out in an instant, have one of my sons dressed like me. I'm like, yeah, that's little me. You know what I'm saying? That's mini, mini me right there. You know what I'm saying? I will rock that in an instant, man. Why? Because, man, those are my baby boys, man. That's my clique. Those are my ride or dies right there. You know what I'm saying? And I just absolutely love it. I so love my boys. My parents so love me and my sister, man. And to the point where growing up where you could not mess with us or my parents would show you that we were ghetto. You know what I'm saying? And unfortunately, still to this day, sometimes that still comes out. I'm like, Mom, I'm 37 years old. I can handle myself. What'd he say to you, boo? We were at a church function basketball game not too long ago, and I was talking to Pastor Rob about somebody who was just being silly and said something to me. And so I was telling people, Rob, I was like, man, it's clown, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I didn't realize that my mom was like Spocking us. So my mom comes over, and I could always tell when my mom is like upset or angry because she has this look. Me and my sister used to call it the pit bull. Her lower teeth come out, and they pass her upper teeth. So she comes over to me. I'm like, oh, Lord have mercy. So I start fanning my mom. I'm like, what's wrong, Mom? She's like, so who was it that said that to you? I said what? What you just said to P. Rob. I said, Mom, it was nothing. Well, yeah, I got you nothing, but who was it? And she's like this, looking at the crowd. Who was it? I'm like, shucks, right? And my mom, man, she so loves us that she still has to act like she's a mother hen to us, man. I'm like, Mom, 37, stop it. But it was him. Right? Praise the Lord, man. And I remember, man, sometimes I think to myself, man, I am not going to be like that with my kids. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to do that. That's silly. And then came Kids Fest that we had here not too long ago. And Elias was in a jumpy ball pit. And I guess he was messing with the side or whatnot. And I'm watching him. I'm like, that's talking about. He's in there with the ball pit, you know, having fun. And as I'm walking over there, I see this lady lean in and go, don't do that again. So I start to walk up there even faster now. I'm like, what is going on? And then she grabbed my son's arm. And I said, whoa, hey. I said, listen here, homie. I said, you need to get your hands off my son. I got this. Don't touch my boy. When he was messing with the side, I said, I really don't care what he was messing with. You're messing with my boy. Do not touch my son. I said, but I appreciate it. Now get up out my way. You know what I'm saying? But you know, I'm like, man, that's my son. You know what I'm saying? Don't touch my son, man. And now I'm like, man, I'm coming just like my mom and my dad. Shucks. Lord, help me in Jesus' name. You know, but man, I will watch them. I will just straight watch them while they sleep. I can become a stalker. Right? Have you ever like stalked your kids? You know, you're just like, man, look at him sleeping. Right? Is he breathing? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. He's breathing. You know what I'm saying? But you just stare at him. You just gaze at him, man. And it's amazing because it's just love, man. And you may be here today thinking to yourself that you're just not quite sure about this whole love thing. You're not quite sure about this whole Jesus thing. I get God, but I'm not sure about Jesus. And I definitely don't understand this whole love thing. What I would say to that is, check it out, man. It doesn't matter what you think about it. Holy Spirit will change your mind. And what's so amazing is, despite the love that you show him, that's not going to interfere with the amount of love that he is going to show you. Yeah. He is going to love you. He's going to watch you. He's going to stalk you. He will be watching you while you sleep. You thought Santa Claus was freaky. This guy, there is no getting away from. Praise the Lord, right? He knows when you've been sleeping and all that stuff. Yeah. Well, Jesus is far greater than Santa Claus. Amen. Praise the Lord. And he watches us all of the time. But look, it's not out to punish us. It's not out to beat us down. It's not out to catch us doing something wrong. He watches us simply because he is so madly and passionately in love with us. And what's so amazing is, we cannot get away from that. We can't. Have you ever seen somebody who's like walks into a spider web and they try to get away from the spider? Myself and Pastor Rob, we were with another man of God one day, man, and we were out in like East Lake or something, and we're walking by this wooded area. So on one side of us is woods, the other side of us is water. Danger to this guy. And so as we're walking, we hear like a bunch of movement in the woods. And the gentleman goes, yeah, that's probably just a bear. You know, we've seen bears out here. So like P-Rob, like it was this guy, P-Rob and me. P-Rob almost shoves me as if I would be bear bait. so he could get closer to the water, which was great because if he dove in the water, I was on his back. I'm just going to tell you, because I was going to drown, so I was going to hold on. I was going to be like a little turtle and just, he'd be getting, I'd just be sunbathing up on his back, praise the Lord, as he's getting us to the other side. But this guy, man, who told us that it was a bear, is just like, yeah, it's probably just another bear. Like he mingles with them daily, right? So we're like, what the heck is that? So, but then fast forward to like 5 minutes later, we walk into this garage barn type thing, and this gentleman walks into a spider web. Mind you, hearing the bear fazed him not at all. He walks into a spider web. He's like, oh my gosh, is it on me? Oh my goodness, is it on me? And we were dying. He could not get away from that spider web quick enough. And he's batting himself, man, hoping that the spider's not on him. And that's how a lot of us are with the love of Christ. Get it off. Oh my gosh, get it off. Get off. Is it on me? Is he on me? Oh my goodness. Get it off. Oh my goodness. And we're trying to bat it away because we just don't understand. But the amazing thing is there's nothing to understand. You just simply surrender. Because you cannot escape. You cannot get away from his love. Do you know why so many of us live crazy, sinful, addicted, selfish lives? Because we're missing one thing. And that one thing we're missing is the love of the Father. And how can I say that? Because love changes everything. Love will literally change absolutely everything in your life. Love. Everything that you begin to, just the life that you begin to despise. Man, when you receive the love that he's been pouring down upon you, you will instantly begin to fall in love with life. Because, man, you've received something that you've never felt before, and that's love. And we're going to see in Scripture how love did literally change everything for a life of a mighty man of God named Hosea. 750 years before love came down in the flesh, Jesus, love was expressed, praise the Lord, through this prophet. And we will begin to see how prophets have phenomenal tasks when we begin to dig into Old Testament. But no prophet had a task quite like Hosea. God is letting him know, I am going to use you. You want to hear some crazy, insane things? Read out of the Message translation, Hosea 1st and 2nd chapter. It's absolutely awesome. And it's us to a T. But anyways, so God's saying, man, I'm going to, through you, demonstrate my love to the people of Israel. And he says, and through your voice, I'm going to tell them the love of the love that I have for the people. See, like we were talking about on Friday night, man, we have to understand that we don't just always have to speak the gospel. The first thing that we should do is show the gospel and then speak it. We don't always have to tell of love. What we should do first is show love. And then when we have the opportunity, then speak it. But God begins to tell this righteous man, this holy man, this prophet, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go out and I want you to marry a prostitute. Huh? Yeah, you heard me. I want you to go marry a prostitute. No, God, I'm good. Nope, won't be needing that. And he's like, no, that's what I want you. But God, why? Marry a prostitute. I'm a prophet. I am a holy man. Why? And God's like, because I asked you. But I don't want to. And God's like, well, I didn't ask you if you wanted to. This is what I'm simply just asking you. This is what I want you to do. We have to begin to understand that everything that God asks us to do, we're not always going to want to do it. And at the same time, we have to understand that everything that God asks us to do, he's not actually asking us to do. He's just being polite. Hello. I shared that with you guys, I think, Wednesday. My daddy used to say to me and my sister, will you take out the trash? It wasn't optional. And I found that out one time when I told him no. No, I'm good, Pops. Mom could get it. He was like, yeah, I know. That's a good point. Let's watch the game. No, I'm picking. But I found out that it wasn't optional, but that he was just simply being respectful by asking. Right? And so, too, the same thing with God. It's not open for debate. This is what I'm asking you to do. My dad used to always tell me and my sister, just listen to me, because one day it may save your life. Do what it is I'm asking you to do, and just listen to me, because one day it may save your life. So here's this holy man, this prophet, known throughout all of Israel, and he's on the hunt for a prostitute to be his wife. The thoughts that had to be running through his mind, the thoughts that had to be running through the minds of the people. Hosea, what are you doing down in the red light district? You out there looking for a prostitute. Man, what are you doing? No, I'm out there looking for a wife. Whoa, shucks. Right, you ain't going to find one out there? No, I am. How you figure? God told me. No, he didn't. Man, shut up with your silly self. He ain't tell you to do that. Yeah. Right? Can you imagine the thoughts that are going through his mind and their mind? And indeed, he finds one. Gomer, and they end up having three kids. Three kids, man, their marriage seems to be going great. One day he wakes up and wifey is nowhere to be found. He begins to check out the house. He's calling friends up, sending out the search party, man. And yet indeed, she's nowhere to be found. This holy man, this top-notch fella, this prophet known so well throughout all of Israel, is now happening to face the fact that he knows, as well as everybody else knows, that his wife is back out there on the streets cheating on. Can you imagine how embarrassing this had to be, how hurtful this had to be, how hard this had to be to shield the ears of his three little babies? Here's this man looking like he has everything together, and he's got to be thinking to himself, God, how on earth can you begin to use me to demonstrate your love if I can't even keep my family together? God, how on earth are you going to use my voice to demonstrate your love and your mercy to the people of Israel if I can't even be the voice for reason for my own wife? Now here she is, she's gone. Think about all these things that had the sleepless days, the sleepless nights, not knowing where she is. Maybe it would have been better if, hey, man, yep, I seen her out there on the corner of beans and rice. You know what I'm saying? I mean, maybe that would have been a little bit easier for him. But yet not knowing where she is. And truth be told, man, some of us live that very thing day in and day out, whether it's with your spouse or your children, not knowing where they are and the torment that goes with that. And then one day God finally is real with him. He says, man, are you ready? Ready for what, Lord? Man, are you ready to get up out of your bed? Are you ready to get up out of your pity party? Are you ready to get up out of your situation? Are you ready to get up out of your circumstance? I asked you to find a prostitute and make her your wife. I never asked you to give up on it. And he says, what are you talking about? He says, get out of bed and go find her. And when you do, renew your vows. Whoa. Huh? Nope. She messed that up. Really, son? Do you want me to tell you how many times you messed this up? But see, love keeps no account of records of wrongs, so I wasn't keeping track of that. And I don't expect you to keep track of hers either. What I expect you to do is go find her, renew your vows, and start all over again. But she messed it up, Lord, and you're going to make it right. It says in verse 1 here, it says, then God, and this is what we caught up, so that's chapters 1 and 2, this is what we catch up, Hosea chapter 3, verse 1, it says, then God ordered me, start all over. Love your wife again, your wife who is in bed with her latest boyfriend, your cheating wife. Love her the way I, God, love the Israelite people, even as they flirt and party with every god that takes their fancy. And what he's talking about is even as they give themselves up to orgies, even as they give themselves up to prostitution, even as they give themselves up to any and every type of lust that it is that they can do, that's what they're doing. And he says, but yet even in that, I am still madly and passionately in love with them. And Hosea, here is your task. Many people would say that's an absolute, ridiculous, stupid task. But many of us don't understand the mind and the love of God Almighty. People are flirting and partying with anything and everything that tickles their fancy. and indulging in any and every sinful thing of the world, man, and they're absolutely loving it. See, truth be told, man, what I love so much about our people here at Source Church, man, Pastor Rob and Pastor Nick, man, when we begin to minister to people, we never lie to them. So we don't go, sin is horrible. Sin is this, sin is that. No, real talk. In some of your seasons, sin is fun. If it wasn't, you wouldn't do it. But what we tell them is your fun is going to end. And then death indeed will begin to come. Because see, sin is going to impregnate you. Make no mistake. Sin don't wear condoms. So sin indeed is going to impregnate you. And you're not going to have a miscarriage. Hello. You're not going to be able to have an abortion. Hello. Sin will give birth. And it will give birth to death. It's take a book. Take a look. It's in the book. You can read it out of James. He lets us know that this is going to happen. The only way we can stop that is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Hello. But we tell people, look, right now, man, everything may be fun for you. Everything may be great for you, thinking to yourself, why should I even give my life to Christ? I'm loving what I'm doing right now. Okay. But this is, I promise you, going to come to an end. And the thing is, Tupac, we don't know when. But it's going to come to an end. People think they're better than life. And the next thing you know, death is right there engulfing you. And now you don't have the option to get covered by the blood. Hello. So we have to begin to grab a hold of this. And this is what they're doing. And they view love in three ways. They believe that love could be purchased. They believe that love was all about self. They believe that love was found in things. It's crazy how the world has changed so much. Oh, wait a second. Hello. So we have to begin to take a look at that. We throw this word love around like it absolutely bears no weight. I love this and I love that and I love this and I love you. You've been with you for 3 days. You don't even know you. But all of a sudden you're in a relationship with you and you just are so madly in love with you. Right? It's absolutely, you want to get married? Yeah, let's go tomorrow. What? It's absolutely insane. But yet we're so quick on that because we don't even know the meaning of love. But yet God's love cuts right through all that nonsense. God's love bears weight. God's love is real. It's not just a word that he throws around. It is everything. It is who he is. And God says, in your whacked out, stressed out, sinful views of love, he says, in your twisted, sick views of love, I'm going to show you what true love actually is. So watch, listen, and experience. See, the greatest expression of love was when Jesus Christ came down, but that's the greatest. But other than that, I would say that the second greatest of expression of love is found in the book of Hosea. God says, man, I am going to express my love through you to the people. Now go and find her. I'm going to be you. She's going to be the people. And now what I'm going to do through you to her is going to minister to all of them. Just do what it is that I'm asking you to do. Right? And praise God that this is exactly what this mighty man does. And you can only imagine the conversation. He's like, yeah, but God, I've already looked. I've already looked and I can't find her. And God's saying, yeah, but go to where you didn't go the first time. Go to where you didn't want to go the first time. Go to where it would have been hard for you to see her the first time that you looked. Yeah, I get it. You sent out a church party with the church. Hello. And all they did was check the church. But actually check the streets where the church don't want to check. Right. Stop sending search parties to the kids' ministry room. Stop sending search parties to the parking lot. Stop sending search parties to the nice neighborhood. Start sending search parties to where you know she's going to be at. Try doing that this time, Hosea. Right? And you got to remember. He said, man, check the streets. Check the gutters. Check where you know. Where you know. She's going to be, Lord, I'm a prophet. What are people going to think if they see me out in the red light district? What about the rumors? I'm a holy man. Right. Now show me that you're a holy man by obeying what it is that I'm asking you to do. So here's this holy man being told by God to go down to the red light district, to go down to the street corners, to go down to the whorehouses to find his wife. How is it that we as a church, imitators of Christ Jesus, have gotten so far away from what true love is and what true love does? See, we believe that the holy man isn't supposed to be down in the red light district. We believe that a holy man isn't supposed to go to the crack house or to the whorehouse or to the strip house. We believe that holy men and women shouldn't be seen in those parts of the neighborhoods. They shouldn't be seen on the streets. They shouldn't be seen in the gutters. We shouldn't go there to find somebody's wife and somebody's sister and somebody's daughter and somebody's mother. We shouldn't go there and pull out somebody's husband and somebody's son and somebody's brother and somebody's father. After all, we're holy. We shouldn't be down in those. We might catch sin. Right. But yet God is telling this holy man that that's exactly where you're supposed to go. Isn't that what we're supposed to do? Because let's just be real. Everybody who is caught in the imprisonment of sin is somebody's daughter, somebody's son, somebody's sister, somebody's brother, somebody's mom, somebody's dad. And above all, is God's daughter or God's son. Aren't we supposed to go and send out the search party? Yeah. And go out into the red light district, whatever that red light district may be, and indeed snatch them away from death's door? This is what he does. He goes and he goes into bad parts of town and he begins to search after his wife. Asking people, man, hey, have you seen my wife? Huh? Nah, soldier, this ain't no area for a wife to hang out. Unless, of course, your wife is a whore. Yeah, so again, I ask, have you seen my wife? Nah, I haven't seen her, holy man. But you might want to go on home now. This is no place for a holy man. And why is it that they begin to believe that this is no place for a holy man? Because holy men and women have been too afraid to go.
Right, right, right.
Wouldn't it be awesome if the red light district began to get swamped with holy men and women? If our neighborhoods begin to get swamped with holy men and women, because then it wouldn't be, you don't belong here. They'd be like, man, where were you? You weren't here. And we needed you because I had somebody who I couldn't minister to, but I know that they don't need to be up on this street corner, so I needed you to minister to them because I don't know what to say. Jesus. Yeah. But you knew what to say, but you weren't here. So this is no place, prophet. And he has to go and ask the pimps and the prostitutes. Have you seen her? Has to ask the Johns. Which I believe had to be the worst. Had to be a little bit easier asking the prostitutes, have you seen her? Tell me. Tell me, have you seen her? Going over to the pimps, man, have you seen her? Going over to the Johns had to be the worst. Check this out. Play this.
Oh yeah, I'm glad I put this tape in.
But you know he had to be.
Look at the stars in the sky. And drifts off into the sweet memories that I have. Of a love that my heart has been searching for so long. And I know somewhere, if I keep looking, that love I'll find. The picture grows clearer and clearer, from the back to the front of my mind. And like love, a love I know I'll have. The girl that I want, she'll be mine. She'll be fly and it'll last. I see her face that I can't let go. She's in my dreams and my heart, so let me know.
Have you seen her?
Have you seen her?
Tell me, have you seen her?
I'm looking for that love. Oh yeah.
Hallelujah. Right? Think about that, man. He had to have been going from person to person. Have you seen her? Have you seen her? Nope. Wait, nope. Nope. Can you imagine getting to the one? Hey, man, I know you frequent here. Have you seen her? She's my wife. And then I'm going, dude. I'm sorry. I didn't know she was your wife. I just got finished up with her not too long ago, man. I apologize. She was down the road there. Take a second left and go straight, and she should be right there. And on the way there, you know, you're pulling out her picture again and asking somebody else, man, have you seen her? Yeah, man, actually I have. I actually just saw her. I got outbidded. Outbidded. Yeah, man, she's on the selling block. And if you go now, then you might be able to get a bid in. And see, scholars believe that when Hosea found his wife, that she was a sex slave. She graduated from prostitution to being a sex slave. Not one that's from a pimp, but one that's captive, and now she's being sold to the highest bidder. You can imagine walking in on an auction of your wife, being sold like cattle, but yet here's the problem. She's not cattle. It's his wife. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine happening to place a bid to buy your wife? Some guy purposely outbidding you. I'll get her. I'll add more to that. Can you imagine what's going on through his mind? The only thing that I could honestly begin to think that is going through his mind is he knows that love will search anywhere. And when the question is asked, when he's up there going, my goodness, what is going on? And these guys are bidding and bidding and bidding and bidding. And then the auctioneer, if you would, looks over at him and says, what about you, sir? How much is it that you're going to bid? How much will you pay? He goes, well, that's my wife. Not today she isn't, sir. She belongs to me. She's my property. And the only way she could become your wife is, well, if you outbid the highest bidder. What do you want to do with this whore anyway, holy man? That's my wife. It's going through his mind, man. Love will search anywhere. No doubt that when he walked into the auction, as horrifying as it had to be, there still had to be a bit of relief that he found her. Obviously not like this, but still had to be a bit of relief that he found her. Wonder how much he was honestly able to look at her. And you know, as happy and relieved as she had to be to hear the voice of her husband at the same time, I could only imagine how difficult it was for her to dare look at him in that state. But I love he steps up and he says, I'll pay the highest price for her. I will pay the highest price for her freedom. And there's no doubt that he had to bid. But we begin to pull up the next scripture, verse 2. This is dope. So I bought her back for 15 pieces of silver and for 5 bushels of barley and a measure of wine. This man purchased his wife back. This is a beautiful picture of what Jesus Christ has done for each and every single one of us. And here's what I love so much. 15 pieces of silver. 15 represents the number of the hand of Holy Spirit, which gives us a new direction in life. Her husband was there to buy her on a command from God to give her a new direction of life. Jesus Christ purchased us to give us a new direction of life. 5 bushels of barley, 5 represents grace. And it was only by the grace of God indeed that we are saved. It's by the grace of God indeed that we have been purchased. Silver represents the divinity of God Almighty. Barley represents humanity. And then you got the wine, baby. You've got the precious wine. The wine, we know what it represents. It represents the precious blood of Jesus Christ. The deal was not sealed until they had a measure of wine. The deal on the cross was not sealed until Jesus said, I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty. And they brought up that wine, that sour vinegar mixed wine. And when it touched his lips, Father, into my hands I commend your spirit. I've shed my blood for the sins of your people. Yeah. Now into your hands I've finished the deal. See, there was no deal just because Jesus was born. There was no deal simply because we believed in who Jesus Christ was. Just because he was born didn't save us from our sins. And just because we would believe in who he was didn't save us from our sins. But because he shed his precious blood, we have been saved and indeed freed. Everything happened because of the blood that Jesus Christ shed. That was the deal clincher. And we see it right there in Scripture, man. Everything Jesus did for us, this man, Hosea, just did for his wife. And that's what God was saying was, the people are going to understand that you represent me and she represents them. And they begin to see all this unfold. He came to say the very words that Jesus Christ would say, I am here to pay whatever the price. Yeah, but how silly do you honestly look buying something that already belongs to you? You're already married, Hosea. She's actually already yours. And he says, I don't care what I look like because love will pay the price no matter what it costs. If I look silly, then I'll look silly. But I'm so in love. Truth is, we are already God's. We're not those who don't believe in him. He's their creator. They might not go with him, but make no mistake, he created them. Satan or sin didn't. The earth is his and everything in it is his. Hello. But Jesus still had to come down to pay the ultimate price by shedding his blood. A price that he knew no one could ever outbid. And this is absolutely amazing. Why? Because love, he shows us that love will search everywhere. Wherever it is that you are at, love will search it. And love will search for you to let you know that he has already paid the price to free you. And it's a price that nobody can outbid. We are already his. But yet, Jesus didn't get into a debate. You ain't got to go to the cross. They're already yours, Jesus. And Jesus says, I love them too much, Satan, to argue with you. I love you too much, angels, to argue with you. This is indeed what I'm going to do. I love them too much to get into a silly, stupid debate. What I'm going to do is simply seal the deal, silence everybody's mouth by shedding my blood to free you and to save you because I know that nobody can match what it is that I'm getting ready to pay. And then what does he do? Praise you, Jesus. He begins to marry us. If I could have my worship team come up. He begins to marry us. He is our bridegroom. And this is awesome. And men, strip yourselves of your pride. And we'll begin to go, you ain't gonna marry me. If you want to taste the goodness of the Lord, then indeed let him be your bridegroom. Because it's absolutely awesome. He marries us. Why? Just like he says, just like Hosea says, check this out. He says, then I told her, from now on, you're living with me. No more whoring. No more sleeping around. You're living with me and I'm living with you. Or an NIV says it like this. Then I told her, you are to live with me many days and you must not be a prostitute or be intimate with any man. And I will behave the same towards you. He's saying, girl, you are mine and I am yours. God is saying to us, Jesus is saying to us, man, I am yours and you are mine. You will belong to no one else. No one will ever pimp you. No one will ever prostitute you. No one will ever cause you to be a whore because you belong to me. But like real talk, could that be your words to your wife that you just purchased back off of the selling block? And what's so amazing, he says this to her, boom, and then instantly addresses the whole sea of people. Holy Spirit consumes him and he speaks to the children of Israel. He says, the people of Israel are going to live a long time stripped of security and protection, without religion and comfort, godless and prayerless. But in time, they'll come back, these Israelites. Come back looking for their God and their divine, their David King. Now, that's what he's basically saying is he's talking about Jesus. He's not talking about King David. He's talking about the man, the Savior, the King, 100% man, 100% God. He's talking about Jesus. And he says, they'll come back chastened to reverence before God and his good gifts, ready for the end of the story of his love. He's saying, people, you are living in and you will continue for a time to live in the fear of God and the fear of his judgment. Now, this is a man who just purchased his wife back, and now he's prophesying to the people. But yet it goes to show you the heart of Jesus, the heart of God Almighty. Well, the God of the Old Testament is a mean God. Then you don't know the God of the Old Testament. And it shows me that you haven't been in the Old Testament. Because the God of the Old Testament is the same God of the New Testament. It's a God of love. It's a God of grace. It's a God of mercy. And he begins to show his heart and tell his heart through the voice of Hosea. And you would think that Hosea would be like, and now since I had to buy my wife back, you're all condemned to hell. Ha ha ha. But no, what's he do, man? He begins to tell them that there's going to come a time that you're going to stop living in this fear. And that indeed you're going to begin to embrace, you're going to be in awe of his goodness, his mercy, his forgiveness, and his love, which is going to lead to change. See, he's saying that he loves us so much that even when we have or have been prostituting ourselves out, when we have left him and put ourselves on humanity's selling block of sin, that God would be so willing to send Jesus. Jesus is that search party that will go into the dirtiest, darkest, raunchiest, scariest places for us. Because love will literally search everywhere for you. And he will indeed pay the price. Why? Because he loves us that much. Understand. Hosea means salvation. Gomer means completion. And what's so awesome is Jesus, when he came for us, he came to offer us salvation. And us and him, we will indeed achieve a completion, praise the Lord, because we will freely give our lives to him. And one day when we are up in glory, it's complete, baby. It is absolutely complete. He will never stop. He will never stop searching for you. I promise you, he will never stop loving you. And he's already paid the ultimate price. Jesus in Matthew 9:13 says this, last scripture. He says this, Jesus overhearing shot back. Who needs a doctor? As he's talking to the Pharisees, as he's talking to the Jews. Who needs a doctor? The healthy or the sick? Go figure out what this scripture means. I'm after mercy, not religion. I'm here to invite outsiders, not coddle insiders. You know what's so amazing about that is oftentimes we quote it, but we don't even know who Jesus is quoting. He's quoting Hosea. How awesome is that? He's quoting Hosea. Hosea means salvation. Gomer means completion. Hosea was to represent the person of Jesus Christ by going after the prostitute. We are the prostitute. We are Gomer. But yet Jesus came out searching for us. Because why? He's after mercy, not a sacrifice. He's quoting Hosea 6, chapter 6, verse 6, and it's amazing. And Jesus is saying this specifically because he knows his hearers are going to know immediately that Hosea means salvation and Gomer means completion. And they're going to know that Hosea was a prophet of God and that God told Hosea to go after the prostitute, the very one that now they're trying to put down, the very one that they're saying is not worthy, is the very one that God said, go after. Go after. And he says, I came to go after every Gomer of this world. That's you and that's me. And that's who he came down for. Why? Because he loves us. Jesus came out of love to find you. Not to make you good. He did not come to make you good. He did not come to make you nice. He came to make you alive. That's what he came to. And he did it because he loves you that much. So if there's anybody in here today as we close in prayer, if there's anybody in here today, you're dead. And there's one who paid the price. And he purchased life for you. He purchased your freedom. If you want that, simply open up your hearts right where you're sitting. We're going to have everybody repeat after me. And if this is you, then mean this prayer. It's not my prayer, it's your prayer if you mean it. Say, Jesus, I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. There was only one, and that's you. I'm a Gomer. I've pimped myself out to whatever sin you fill in the blank. But Jesus, I thank you that you're my redeemer, my rescuer. I thank you, Jesus, that you're my Savior, that you purchased me with your blood. And it was a price that no one or no thing can ever outbid. So I'm yours, and you're mine, and I thank you. And all God's baby said,